So the French team being introduced first, Siraba Dembele, hugely experienced playing in her second Olympic Games. And interestingly, in her case, she is Russia-bound. She's going to be playing with Rostov Don next season. Glossaire, the goalkeeper we just saw, has been absolutely superb. Alison Pinault-Aiglon just before her, two of the most experienced players in the team. And then we move on to Lino, goalkeeper, who's also had a great tournament, 37% save rate. Nyombla, who's going to really need to be on song. And right at the end, Lacrabert, top scorer for the French team. He's been on blinding form with a 65% success rate for the right back, who herself played in Russia for a while with Zvezda Zvenigorod. She's the back, though, now with Nice, but heading off to Macedonia. And here are now the Russians, starting with Bliznova, their captain. They've got an embarrassment of riches at the back, the Russian Sen, who's comfortable at right back, left back, or indeed on the line. Yakireva, who really has been their standout player, playing on the right wing, but then happily moving into the right back position when required with her 31 goals. And Bobrovnikova, one of many players, Zilinkaitis another, who give them so many options at the back, and all of them on very good form. Ilina, very clever, very quick back player. And finally, Petrova, the line player. And then the goalkeepers, they've got the high numbers on the Russian team. Erokina, who came in for the injured Sidoikina halfway through the group stages. And Kalinina, a real revelation for the Russian team. Plays for Maikop, but is moving off to the champions Astakhanochka next season. So those then are the two teams. The referees, Guro Roen and Kirsti Jansen, who are benefiting from Norway not being in the final for once, and they are great, great pair of referees, and really pleased to see them stepping up to the very top game here in this Olympic final. Great moment for them. And now, with all the presentations made, it's going to be time for the national anthems, and it will be France first.
In their first ever Olympic final, and La Marseillaise very well appreciated around the stadium, but they have got to get past Russia if they want to win the gold medal. Almost time for France versus Russia in the Olympic final in the women's handball. Fascinating watching the French players singing the national anthem there. All of them looked focused except for Tamara Horacek, who had a big smile on her face throughout the entirety of singing the anthem. She can't quite believe, I imagine, that she's ended up here in the Olympic final, having not even been selected in the tournament so far. So they exchanged some little gifts, and the balls will get thrown into the crowd. for the pretty much capacity crowd here that have made their way into the Future Arena. The atmosphere is absolutely buzzing, and there are some of the Russian fans, and here are the team lists.
So for France, well, Lacabert at the right back, competition second top scorer with 44 goals, should start at the back with Pino and Njomblad. Dembele effective on the left wing, but on the right wing, Boulou's injured. She's replaced by a back player, Horacek. It leaves only Pouvancier as their winger, while Glossaire, with a 42% save rate, the best in the competition, and still she doesn't always start. For the Russians, Vyakireva has been the outstanding player for them. The right back should start, in the wing on this occasion, move to the back position as the match goes on. Kuznetsova, her sister on the left wing, also on good form. They've got an embarrassment of choices at the back, while Kalinina has been strong in goal, but again, Erokina starting more often than not. Olivier Krumholz, the coach of the French team, let go and then brought back, while Yevgeny Trefilov, well, he left after the last Olympic, but was also asked back, both coaches then being called back in the nation's hour of need. For France, and well, can Krumholz pull off the unthinkable? He'll need Lacabert to be at her very best with her 44 goals so far, 65% success rate, above average for a back player. Doing very well indeed, but Vyakireva is the answer for the Russians. 31 goals, starts on the right wing usually, but equally comfortable at the right back position. 66% success rate for her. And Glossaire there in the orange top, number one, who's got superb save rate, 42%, making her the top goalkeeper in the tournament. But it's Lino who's the more experienced of the two and so often starts.
Russia get the Olympic final in the women's handball at Rio 2016 underway here at the Future Arena. They're in the blue playing from left to right. France in the white playing from right to left. Seven players on each side, but you can rotate the bench freely throughout the two 30-minute halves. And it's Russia who are coming forward immediately. And the whistle goes and it'll be a free throw for them. You're allowed three steps before you've got to dribble the ball, and you can only hold onto the ball for 3 seconds. Here come Russia then, in the early stages. Dmitrieva gets it out to Bliznova, comes back inside, there's the shot, and the first shot saved by Amandine Leno.
So interesting that Krumholz, always comfortable shuffling the deck, but he's not put on Lacabert at the start in defence. Aiglon, who's a defence specialist, but not normally swapping with Lacabert, but Lacabert has now come on the far side. In the centre, we've got Njombla, Pino at the left back. And the Russians starting with a deep defence, almost a 3-3 here. And at the back, Petrova is having to keep a very close eye on Edwige, the French line player. They put in a second line player to try and flatten things. Pino tries to go around and find a gap. It's going to be a free throw. Vyakireva gets the finger from the referee. You're on my bad books. And there's White. And then she was caught late. Petrova very high. Whistle already gone, though. Bit of a let-off for her. Pino, former World Player of the Year, playing for Baia Mare in Romania, but heading home to play in Brest in France. Club newly promoted to the French top division. And a rather soft shot by Lacabert, the initial one, and it's deflected away very comfortably by Erokina.
Oh, but there's the fumble, and now Eglon picks it up. Pacing forward is Dembele, and that's the first goal of the Olympic final. And it comes for Siraba Dembele, 2 minutes into the match. Really weak play from Russia, just the fumble there, picked up by Aglon, who picked out Dembele. It was Daria Dmitrieva who dropped it for Russia.
Well, to give Dmitrieva some defence, it was a terrible pass out by Erokina, way short of the intended player, and forced her to backtrack. Bliznova's pulled down, though. She's won the free throw, trying to tussle her way past Njombla. So Vyakireva has started at the right-back position straight away. Bliznova, good save! Oh, nearly going through. Lino picks it up, though, and the French try to speed forwards. Normally, the Russians are the ones who like the fast pace in the attack. And shot by Pino, way wide of the goal. Quick exchanges between both teams here, trying on the long-range shots, and another save! Well, Lino, three saves inside 3 minutes.
So now the French will try and come forward. Out to the wing, the whistle had already gone though. You're not allowed to go inside that red area, but if you're shooting, you can jump in and land inside. But again, Leno just about doing enough to keep the ball out. France 1, Russia 0. And here come the French again with Pino to Dembele. In the centre there is Niambla, and over on the right is the left-handed Lacroix-Bert, who will cut inside often and go for goal.
So, slow build-up then, Lacroix-Bert, who loves to come right the way across to attack between two and three, and a poor pass by Pino, who's lacking a little attention here, trying to connect with Pouvancier, the only right-winger left in the French team, and she was a replacement for the injured Bulle and Dansette, and so they've really had to turn things around, the French. Oh, that nearly goes out. Play on, says the referee. The French with a 6-0 defence, but they've got to have good depth on it because the Russian players play a nice, fluid, fast game, and a good save, and the pickup will be irrelevant because a penalty has been given, a foul in the act of shooting. It was against number 7, Daria Dmitrieva. And so Vyakireva, who's got an enviable record, steps up to take a 12 penalty scored from 16. Scores comfortably, and her first goal of the game gets Russia off the mark in the final.
So France 1, Russia 1, as we approach the 5-minute mark, considering the amount of efforts both sides have had. Quite a low-scoring first 5 minutes. But Vyakireva making no mistake with that one, just 21 years old. And now here come the French with Niambla. Little ball back to Lacroix-Bert. Only one shot for her so far, and it was a bit of a tame effort. And in comes Dembele, and really good work from Erokina to read the shot and close her legs in time to block it. Very quick break now from Russia. And Russia are in the lead. It's Dmitrieva who tucks it into the back of the net. France 1, Russia 2, but now here comes France. What a fast-paced match this is, as it comes out to Pino and it's into the side netting. Wow.
Blistering start by both sides. We knew the Russians would force the pace. The French usually like to slow things down. They've probably got one of the best defences in the competition, and that's how they've won the games against the faster teams like the Netherlands. But here, the French are trying to up the tempo. And the clock's been stopped briefly there. Discussion going on between the referee and number 24, Edwige, the line player. So, the French trying to play the Russians on the fast game here. And the Russians bring in their wingers, very good, strong wingers. Kuznetsova from the left side. She's come in, flattened the defence. And again, Linu makes a great save. Goalkeeper who plays for Vardar Skopje in Macedonia holds the ground, offers the inside post and then switches over. 2-1, the score remains. Second line player goes in, Vyakireva comes in, shrieks from the French players trying to alert each other, and another good save. Linu, what a start by the French keeper. That's a fifth save from 7 shots. And that's inside 6.5 minutes.
There you can see it, and Russia have made 2 saves from 3 shots. But nevertheless, it shows that Russia are making a little more progress when they go forward compared to the French, and the Russians are 2-1 up at the moment. Here's Dembele cutting inside. Little play back into Lacroix-Bert, into Pino. Whistle had gone for an attacking foul. You're not allowed to jump into the players that are trying to block you, and now Russia come flying forward out of the wing and into the net. And that's the first goal of the game for Polina Kuznetsova, coming in off that left wing. And Russia now 3-1 up.
Well, nicely played, simple overlap, not a huge angle, but she jumps towards the middle. And as the goalkeeper goes down, just takes some of the pace off it, runs the fingers back. 7.5 minutes played, then a good start by the Russians, and the French maybe want to slow the pace down. They do here now, start to build up slowly, but the acceleration will come as Dembele, the winger, is coming in, trying to flatten the defence, tried to pull one in, it worked. Just bought enough space for Pouvancier, who scores only her second goal of the Olympics after coming in midway through the group stages. Good block by her as well now, Pouvancier, but it drops down and comes off her foot. The Russians with a free throw, and it's been fairly breathless stuff here early on. And so Akopian is on the far side, Dmitrieva in the centre and Vyakireva at right back, with Bliznova normally the right back, starting in the wing. That's way over the top, but a shove on the way and a yellow card for France's Beatrice Edwige. Player for Nice, who's moving to the Champions Metz next season. He's only scored four goals, four from four, mind you, but she wins a lot of penalties. Real focus for the defence. So Bliznova goes in as a second line player, trying to pull the defence back. Vyakireva comes around, she'll hand off. Akopian looking for the space. Lovely interchange, penalty. The foul on Petrova. Crossovers, multiple crossovers for the Russians until the line opens up. And when it does, Eglon is standing inside the area.
So a chance again for Vyakireva to find the back of the net from the 7-metre throw. She's converted one already in this gold medal match. And it's saved again by Leno. What a start to the match for the 30-year-old goalkeeper. Three times she's been named the best goalkeeper in the French top division. And that's why.
Well, she reacted well. She offered the side. The opposite side was playing mind games with Vyakireva and then reacts very well because she's standing quite a way forwards. So chance goes begging for the Russians off that penalty, and France still just one goal behind. And they've changed at the left back now. Nziminko has come on number 27 in place of Nyombla. And it'll be a free throw. She got a shove as she went to shoot. Nziminko, who's had the mixed success, 13 goals, but only 48% success rate. Maybe a tad below par for a back player. Here she is again then, Pino in the middle, who's misfiring a bit with her shooting at the moment, needs to find her range. Second line player goes in on the line. And we've got another bit of pushing and shoving going on, and yet another yellow card, Vyakireva. Referee rather elaborately demonstrates that the hip came into play. There it is, put her leg across. So, France resumed, 10 minutes played, 3-2 to Russia. The French trying to play quick. That's another push by the line player Petrova. And Pino wins another free throw.
Out to Lacroix-Bert, who's been a little bit quiet so far in the match. There's the effort. It's a good save. It was Nziminko with the shot, but now Russia on the fast break. Dmitrieva trying to drive in, but it's an attacking foul. And now France will try and break back. Dembele. Oh, no! Dembele misses, shakes her head, and well, she might. France 2, Russia 3 still. But what an opportunity.
Well, a great opportunity. She'll be kicking herself, Dembele, for doing that. Hard shot, 72 kilometres an hour, but puts it round under the keeper's arm. Clips the post, but well on the outside.
So that'll be a free throw now to Russia. Only five goals in the opening 11 minutes. Cagey stuff in this Olympic final. Whistle goes, a free throw again. The foul from Dembele, keeping out Vyakireva.
So the French really now need to slow the pace down. It's how they succeed against these teams. They've got to dictate the pace and not try and play at the Russians' pace, because in attack they're failing. But in defence, so far so good, they're holding strong. Switch back, Yelena comes across. Akopian tries to windmill pass, but gets nowhere. And that's an attacking foul again. And Lino is straight in there, wanting to look for the long pass, but there's an injury. And finally, they slow things down as Pino, trying to get her breath back after this, got there. And there's the shoulder barge by Yelena, and quite sure has winded her. Goes straight over. 27-year-old. Scored 502 goals for France in 189 internationals. Been around, played for Vardar Skopje in Macedonia, Krim Ljubljana in Slovenia, and then now Baia Mare in Romania before returning to Brest in France. There's Yelena, who caught her. No sanction against her, it was just in the run of play, but obviously a foul barge, and that's Pino who's off. And France, who've been struggling a little bit at the back when they changed their starting lineup. Third turnover for France, that was. But they do have one extra back player, because the only replacement player they had out here after Bülow, the right winger, was injured, was Horacek, a playmaker. But in fact, it's Zadi who comes on. Zadi, who was their top scorer when they met in the World Championships last year, Russia and France. She scored six against the Russians. But it's Nziminko who gets France going again and levels the score 3-3 here with her first success from three shots. The Russians have been kept quiet for a little while here.
So let's see what Russia have got as they now push forward with Bliznova on the near side, number 24. In the middle there is Dmitrieva. Vyakireva comes back inside. Dmitrieva, and again, trying to find the line, but it was well blocked off. Two players on the line now for Russia. Goes out of the wing. Lovely little turn from Kuznetsova and finds the back of the net. Really nimble out there on the left wing. And the 29-year-old cuts back inside and scores once more. Up to 350 goals now for her country.
So for France, the pace has slowed. It's the right thing to do. And Zadi, number 10 in the middle. Just one goal from 10 attempts. Wasn't used at all in the quarter-final or semi-finals. 36 minutes of play, in fact, in the whole competition. Lacrabert. Zadi finds the line. Good defending, stopped her from turning, but that's the third and final yellow card for the Russians. And as ever, Idwi's causing all manner of problems at the back, the line player. It was a very nice connection. The two who will be together at Metz next year. After Idwige makes a move from Nice and she gets up again after once more being brought down. She thinks that should have been more. Let's have a look as Lacrabert connects. Ball never reaching her. Dmitrieva knocks it away unfairly, but it's a free throw only. So Lacrabert been quiet with the shooting at the moment. It's almost as if she's afraid of taking the shots for the moment. She's coming in, she's looking for the line, looking for the pass wide, but hasn't quite let rip. She's probably got the hardest shot in the French team. Well cut out this time. Kuznetsova immediately jumped up in front of her. She tried to cut across. Now she's got a bit more space, but they push up deep on her. Zadi straight onto the keeper. She's pushed down though, and she'll come back, the Mets back player. Good defending once more, and it's Kuznetsova who's doing a real good job at the back. The winger who's defending second in on the far side. Comes out again. Oh, looking for a little Kempe, but that was a flat ball through. Nziminko would have had to have wings to catch that and shoot before she landed. Bliznova, now they've got the wing free. Wasn't a great pass, what a shame. And they have to start again. It just needed a clean finish by Yakupyan. Both teams making changes between attack and defence. Oh, quarter from behind, that's going to be off. And Edwige, who's already had 8 2-minute suspensions in the competition, gets a first in the final. And there she is. Catches her from behind. You've got to let go now. Once you're behind, you're going to be in trouble with the referee. She knows it. Trefilov, never one to stay quiet on the bench, bellowing instructions to the back. Midway through the first half, then Russia lead 4-3 in a low-scoring affair here, dominated by strong defending on both sides.
There is Lacrabert, wincing as she gets back up to her feet, having been knocked to the ground and conceding the foul. Here it is again. Little push there and ends up on her back, quite a heavy little landing actually. And there is Evgeny Trefilov, who's just getting his opinion across. Vyakireva, it's Russia who have got the player advantage here because the French are down to six, trying to wriggle in. Penalty for Russia. Another chance for Vyakireva from the 7 metre line, defending inside the area called, I think it's against Aglon. There's that little cut inside there. Yeah, there's the left foot of Aglon.
Also caught her arm a bit. So well done by Bliznova. She points to the area, but she didn't need to worry. Referees had this in hand. So Lino will stay in goal. She saved only one penalty from 15 taken, but to change a penalty taker, Ilina it is. 4 from 4 so far. Make that 5 from 5 here at the Olympic competition.
16 minutes played. France 3, Russia 5 in the gold medal match here. And after a great save last time from Leno, nowhere near getting that one.
Committed herself very early. So back come France, and they've changed now on the left wing. Huet has replaced Dembele after the captain only scored one from three. Bulleu, or rather Prouvencier, is coming around. She now heads straight back out again. Nzeminko gets another push. Every time she's coming around, she's being seen to by Petrova, the big line player, 1.84 meters. And they've got a free throw, and for the moment, Iglon is staying at right back, and Lacrabert has been recycled into the center. Nzeminko tries to go through, gets a free throw, as Vyakireva dispossesses her unfairly.
France now can bring on their seventh player. And there's the effort from Provencier, which was ambitious more than anything. Maybe would have helped to just wait a couple of seconds till they were back up to full strength. Now here come Russia. Out to Akopian, number 10 here on the edge. Little ball back to Bliznova. Then fired in by Dmitrieva. Rattles into the back of the net. A thumbs up from Trefilov on the sideline, because Russia now have a three-goal advantage. Russia 6, France 3 in the Olympic final.
Simple overload move by the Russians, moving quickly from one side to the other. Drive in and pass, move to the next gap. Yields benefits in the end. So France come back then, trailing 3-6 in the 18th minute of the final at Rio 2016 in the women's handball competition. Deep defence by the Russians, waiting at 9 meters, but for France, Pino is back on again after being winded earlier on in an incident. Seems none the worse for it. Veteran playmaker. Here she comes. Hasn't quite managed to exert her authority on the game, as neither has, for that matter, Lacrabert, but that's a penalty. The pass well ahead, and Nzeminko had to do well to catch and shoot before stepping into the area. But she was shoved as she came through. There it was. Vyakireva trying to intercept it, but to no avail. Penalty is given. Up steps Pino.
Pino converts it. The first penalty of the match for France from the 7-meter line. And Pino finds a way past Victoria Kalinina. Tatiana Erokina. In the goal, tucks it into the bottom right, and Pino scores. So France back to within 2, Russia 6, France 4, with just 11 minutes to go in this first half. Inside comes Bliznova, hands it out now to Bobrovnikova, who we haven't seen much of in the match so far. Here is Bobrovnikova, who has scored 27 goals in the tournament so far, number 17. Little turn from Akopian, manages to get it in, penalty given. It was Marinikova who was brought down, and another penalty for Russia.
Well, Marinikova, normally a wing player, but she's been used here on the line quite a few times by Trefilov. Got a good build for it. Really never got a roaming shot up to take it, but still wins the penalty, and Ilina comes up once more to the 7-meter line. Top corner, Leno started to go down. And she knew nothing about that one. Put away very nice, his second penalty scored. Keeper goes down, she offers her the top spot, and Ilina says, well, thank you, I'll do it.
Rifled in.
So, well played by Rostov Don's Ilina. And the France resumes. Nzeminko still at the left back. Pino, they switch. Trying to put two in on the center, and she just cannot range her shot at all. And we're past the 20-minute mark in the final, and for Russia, so far so good. Not a lot of goals for them, but they've managed to score 7 times. More to the point, they've restricted France to just 4 goals in 20 minutes. And the save rate high at both ends, 46% for Lino, but Erokina on 50%, well above her own average. 28% for her so far in the competition. Lots of changes by Russia at the back, and they do have an embarrassment of choices. Bobrovnikova is the one who's come on now. Vyakireva, long-range shot off the post. No luck there, but it's come back for Russia on the rebound. Bliznova. But we've got players lying inside the area, and the whistle is blown, and Guro Roen, the referee, waves everybody out. Here's the incident again. Two going for the loose ball. I think Edwige probably bringing down Marienikova, but it's just a free throw with 9 minutes remaining in the first half.
Frustration for Russia there, because they look to be in a really good position out on that right wing, with everybody lying in the area, meant there was no defenders around. Here's Bakireva back into Kuznetsova, who's come inside. Little bounce from Bakireva, hands it back off to Akopian. France defending big and defending strong at the moment. And the arm is up, so passive play called against Russia, which means they only have six passes and they'll have had a couple of those already. And a timeout called by the Russians. And let's see what Evgeny Trefilov has got to say to his team. They're three goals up.
So the French coach looking to shuffle his players around a little bit, telling them to make sure they work in their line, keep to their lines of attack at the moment, and driving in on each side rather than across into each other's way. And Lino, he's had a great game, but passive play call is still running for the Russians, and they've used up some of the six passes allowed after the referee's arm goes up. They know they've got to shoot soon. And that'll eat up one more pass, and the Russians are going to end up with one passing shot as Lacrabert stares at the referee, trying to will her to count one extra pass. Well, and he's still worried about the faulty substitution there, Vyakireva. Look at this, and far out is Bliznova, in fact, just beats Lino. Big smile from the captain.
So Russia with a four-goal advantage. Here come France. It's saved by the feet of Erekina, but a free throw given as Niombla tried to make something happen. France 4, Russia 8, with just 8 minutes to go in this first half. Niombla a little bit behind Pino, but she manages to get there anyway. Dives in, penalty given, hits the post, and a yellow card given to Polina Kuznetsova. And Kuznetsova disagrees, I think, with that decision, but there we go, bit of a push.
I think her argument's with a teammate, saying, why was no one calling her when she's coming around? They're letting her carry on. She's got to mark a back player, and now she's having to backtrack onto Pino. Lacrabert to take it. Kalinina, who's just come into goal, tried everything, but Lacrabert stays cool and scores her first goal of the game for France. It's taken nearly 23 minutes for that. Sends her one way first as she picks herself up, waits for her to commit herself, and then between arm and leg. Need a little bit more from her now, though, Lacrabert.
Finally off the mark, the woman from Po, and there comes Vyakireva. Free throw given, and Amandine Leneau rather despairingly looks at the referee and says, I just made an amazing save. Doesn't count for anything, though. Russia still with the ball. Here they come. Long shot, saved again by Leno. The effort came in from Bobrovnikova. And now France try and come forward with some pace. Dembele back inside to Pino. Little laid up to Aiglon, who's still on the court. No sign of... Lacrobert's out on the right wing now. What a good game Leno's having, though.
Well, Leno certainly influential for France and keeping them in contention there. That's 50%. Save rate now for her, and actually the Russians dropping slightly. But France upping the tempo again as they look for options on the line now. Landré has come in for Edwige. And also Niombla has returned in place of Mzeminko Zadi. The experiment there lasted only as long as Pino needed a breather. Marienikova gives away the free throw. France will stay on the attack. And a frustrated-looking Alison Pino, one goal from three. Whistle's gone, though. They'll have to come all the way back. It's a free throw for France. Slightly delayed whistle there by the Norwegian referees. So the pass up, Landry. Penalty. Well, she was having to turn her whole body. She was running away from the goal, trying to turn in midair. But as she did so, Bobrovnikova caught her awkwardly, pushing her over. She gets 2 minutes, and France have a penalty. She'd managed to get past Vyacheva, did very well, because she engineered something of almost nothing there. And Trefilov, well, need we say more?
Is Lacrobert for a second chance from the line and a second goal from the line from Alexandra Lacrobert. And now France get the gap back to 2 goals, and for the next 2 minutes they're going to have a player advantage. So if they can just withstand this Russian attack, that's what it means to Lacrobert in her third Olympic Games.
So with short-handed Russians, the French are defending up on 9 metres. That's a free throw, though. They thought initially they had the break, and Pino can't believe it. She's still shaking her head, and the bench is saying, get on with it, forget it, forget it. Elina Bliznova. Akopian. Looked a bit like an attacking foul. Very delayed reaction, but it's given in the end. A long pass down. Lacrabert does well. Too many steps anywhere, but she'll go back and get the free throw. Kuznetsova doing very well to come back and cover what looked like a clear shot on goal otherwise. There's the attacking foul, shoulder in first into the defender who was static at the time. Eglon very quickly, right back to right back. But there's the good block by Kuznetsova getting in the way. Nicely played into the wing. Oh, and the wing problems for France continue, this time on the left side. Dembele comes up short-handed. Dembele, who's moving to Russia to play for Rostov Don next year. Oh, I think the goalkeeper almost as surprised as everybody else that the ball even left Landry's hand, and it just lofts slowly over her shoulder. It was almost sent by second-class post.
So Landry finds the back of the net, and that is her first goal of the match, her 17th of the competition, her 75th. For France, and France back within 1 goal. They've taken good advantage of the power play, and now the ball has gone out. A weak pass from Russia, and France have the opportunity to come forward and try and draw level. 3 minutes to go in this first half.
Complete lapse of attention by the Russians there. 5 turnovers. They seem to have a control over this game. They were forcing the pace. Their attack's very fluid in front of the French team. And then now they've lost the initiative, but it's a team timeout called by France on this occasion. And Lacrabert and her teammates go back for a quick word with Krumholtz. So Krumholtz saying you've got to force it more into the 6 metre line, because they're giving away the penalties if you're willing to take on the one-on-one and fight them for it. And also reminding them that the goalkeeper, Irokina, is going down very quickly, especially when the French players are under pressure taking the shot, working on the basis that they're more likely under pressure to shoot low than high.
So just under 3 minutes remaining in this first half, and what a fascinating first half. It's been relatively low scoring as far as Russia are concerned, and as far as general handball games are concerned. You can usually expect a halftime score maybe upwards of 10 for each side. Here comes Pino, long shot, rattles the bar. What an opportunity that was for France to draw level. Now Russia can come on the counter. Out to the left, then back inside for Dmitrieva. Russia just slow it down so they can turn over their players. 7 players allowed on the court at any time, doesn't matter which they are, you can swap around as much as you want. Dmitrieva out to Bliznova, number 24. Dmitrieva trying to drive in herself, oh, trying to get it into Anna Sen, and she is heavily felled.
Well, Landry just getting in the way, then shoving her out of the way of the ball. It was very direct. Bliznova comes looking for the gap, goes to the wing. Kuznetsova, brilliantly played, drops her wrist back again and takes the pace off. And the 29-year-old who plays for Astrakhanotchka, look at the wrist, just lifts over and beats Lino.
So 40 seconds after they could have gone level, France now find themselves 2 goals down. France 7, Russia 9. There's the goals to shot on goal percentage. Russia converting 53% of their efforts, only 41% for France. Niombla trying to drive in. And a real shriek of pain from Larissa Landry there as she went down under the pressure from Bliznova. But I think Landry thinks there was a bit of an elbow in there. Keep an eye out here. Couldn't really see too much untoward.
Six of one, half dozen of the other, but this certainly wasn't an elbow. Getting a little bit worked up, maybe. But France lucky, I thought, because Niombla seemed to go in and turn her back on the defender. Doesn't matter anyway, because as she tries the next shot, Irokina up to that one. And so with 1 minute and 10 seconds remaining in the first half, Russia on the attack with a 2-goal lead. Iglons come back into defence. Lacrabert has moved out wide now with Pino on that side there, but a lot of the problems are coming. Looking for the wing, no way through this time, and the two veteran right-backs, Iglon and Lacrabert, go flying together, both of them playing the third Olympic Games. So they've got Zielinskite now on at the left-back position. Bliznova again, but they switch back briefly, and Bliznova has to return. We've got 30 seconds remaining, and passive play being warned. Good save, that goes out, throw in to the Russians. Well, that was fortuitous for them. Restarts the clock. Her arm's gone down, and the Russians have a longer attack. Bliznova looks for the line. They're crowding out, and that's fine. The Russians happy to have the last attack. Quick look at the clock by Bliznova. 10 seconds. Got to time it right, though. Stay away from the block so the French can't mark you. That's perfect. Impeccable timing by the Russians. And almost on the stroke of halftime, Sen scores her first goal and stretches Russia's lead.
Well, what a fascinating first half in this Olympic final. Here's a look at that goal again. Just fed in from Bliznova. Anna Sen managed to turn, find the back of the net and score her 15th goal of the tournament so far, and that gives Russia a 3-goal advantage at halftime in this gold medal match in the women's handball. Some stuff for Olivier Krumholz to think about at halftime, because his side trail, it's France 7, Russia 10 at halftime in the women's handball gold medal match here at Sochi 2016. So the atmosphere is building inside the Future Arena. The fans know that in 30 minutes, we may well have a gold medal winner. If it's still level at 30 minutes, we go into 2 times 5 minutes of overtime. If it's still level, there's another 2 times 5 minutes of overtime. And then, if it's still level, we go to penalties. But that's a long way off, because it's Russia who lead by 10-7. And it's France on the attack, in the white, playing from left to right. And the blue is Russia. And Lacrabert almost getting a shot in. It opens up a bit for Dembele, out to the wing. Oh, into the net. Provencier finding the near post. France 8, Russia 10. Second goal of the game for Provencier.
Jerokina tempted off the line, but now the Russians have a shot, and that looked like interference, but it's not given. And France break away. Pino fast on the right. Provencier is free, but she's missed the opportunity. Lacrabert, who still isn't looking like she's fully into the game, and a giveaway by France. Turnover. Only had 3 in the first half. That's their fourth one, fifth, and that's the payment they've got at the other end, I'm afraid. Glusser, nothing she could do about that. And Dmitrieva gets her 3rd goal, and it could have been a different story altogether.
Driving straight through the middle there, Dmitrieva, and firing it into the right-hand side of the goal. So France 8, Russia 11, a much more action-packed opening to this half. Took us quite a while to get our first couple of goals at the start of the first half, but it's all a little bit more lively now. Lacroix-Bert in the centre, trying to find room for a shot, and it's saved by the legs, and now Russia are on the break. Out with Sudakina, the whistle goes, and the referee shakes her head as Marina Sudakina, Sudakova, drove through to try and find the back of the net.
Too many steps, obviously, after the impact, and therefore the referees couldn't give it to her. But again, the ball lost by France at the other end as Lacrabert was desperately looking for the line rather than shot. The shot was an afterthought and therefore wasn't a very good one. Comfortably saved, and now the break is on. The Russians on the attack. Dmitrieva cuts back towards the middle. Constant changeovers. They're crossing, going to one side, going back to the other. And the line player readjusting. Maria Nikova trying to find a way through. And in fact, it's Sen who's gone in now on the line.
Oh!
That was lucky. Clips the post and nearly went back in off Glossier, the goalkeeper. France stream forwards. Now they're playing fast as they were early in the game. It didn't really suit them, in fairness. They're all about defence and then bringing the ball up. But for Glossier, well, that's a good start. Get the first save under the belt. Did well to duck down and stay out of the way of the ball.
So France coming forward now. Just with that too many steps that was called against Sudakova earlier on. You're only allowed three steps without bouncing the ball and dribbling. And now here come France trying to get a shot in, and it rattles off the bar from Lacroix-Bert. Nothing so far the 29-year-old can do in her third Olympic Games. The star of the French team, their top scorer. What a lovely pass that is! And it's finished off by Polina Kuznetsova. And Russia now have a four-goal advantage.
So the release coming in there. Lovely back pass in by Zelinskaya, and Kuznetsova opened up a huge angle, and Glossier was always going to struggle to cover that, especially with her accuracy rate. And so France coming back 3.5 minutes in. Pinot is off for the time being. And into the centre has gone Nyombla. He would normally play more left, and Zimienko is the attacker. Late think about that one again. They're very slow with the whistle, but it's a free throw, and he thought it should have been a penalty. And replay may show that she's broken through, and therefore it should be a penalty. So free throw it is. Lacrabert. This time she does find it. It would have been a penalty anyway. Well, it's given, because she'd landed back inside the area before she released the ball. And as ever, Edwige, with only four goals in the competition, but winning so many penalties. This another one. She steps well inside the area, couldn't really give that one.
So it'll be a 7 metre throw. And in comes Kalinina to try and make the save. And it's going to be Pinot who will take it. This to bring France back within three goals. Alison Pinot scores. France 9, Russia 12, 4 minutes into this 30-minute second half.
So she tries to commit the goalkeeper, dummies the first shot, and then just decides, well, I'll go quickly for the top corner now as her arm's coming down. Bench are happy with that. So Russia coming back, and now the two players in from each side for France, pushing a lot deep onto the back players, nearly losing it there. Dmitrieva. And they're trying to push up now and be more aggressive on the Russian back players. Coming up to 9 metres. It's a dangerous tactic with a solid line player at the back. Anna Sen waiting. Holds her own, but a little worried, Nzimenko. Loud blow with the whistle. Sometimes means you've got yourself a 2-minute suspension. Did she turn her or not? Managed to just about stay in front, but by the skin of her teeth. So Bliznova looking across for the options. Pinot, who's now, after taking that penalty, staying on court. Shifted completely over defensively, where she was on the right side of the defence as the goalkeeper's looking at it from behind to the left side. Lacrabert is in on the right side. Long-range shot under pressure. And that sails over the goal, and France can move the ball back up again. Pinot slots into the centre. Cut back inside, Pinot, and again the French shooting is hitting that post with annoying regularity as far as Kuhlmholtz is concerned. Rokina glad for that, a smile as she looks down, and that's two attacks running almost. The French have clipped the post, Lacrabert first, Pinot now. What more can you do?
That is Olivier Kuhlmholtz, the coach of the French side. And there's the conversion rate for France, 39% shots to goals. Anna Sen now picks it up, wins the free throw. Always going to be an ambitious one to try and turn and shoot while standing from there, but wins the free throw nevertheless.
Lacrabert, though, stepping in quickly to make sure it was only a free throw, not a penalty. That's going to be another free throw for the Russians, and goals are hard to come by at both ends with the French because, well, they can't quite get the measure of their shooting, but the Russians are finding a very, very tough defence. They knew they would. Oh, smuggled in. Misread by Glusev, but the fans are happy. Vyakireva scores again.
Now France come immediately back with Lacrobert, a little dart to the inside, and they've managed to find Edwige, but it's a really good save by Erekina. Edwige with the chance, looked like she didn't quite have her balance. Now Anna Sen charging forward, and the foot gets to it from Laura Glusev.
End-to-end stuff here, and Edwige, that's her first miss in the competition from an actual shot. It was under some pressure, and again, Lacrobert just can't find a way through. The Russians are watching her like a hawk, and she loves to go right across to the other side and look for the gaps between the far defender and the next one in, or that one and the next one. She literally will cross the entire court. They know that. They're looking out for it. It's also why the right winger for France is not getting a huge amount of service. Pouvancier waiting patiently, dispossessed. Vyakireva straight down the middle. Zielinskaya. She's bounced it too hard. It sails past the front of the goal. And Vyakireva, who stole the ball and passed it, thumps the bench in frustration. There was the take. Makes the pass. She then runs off, only to watch the shot sail over the bar. Good pressure, mind you, from Nyombla. So back come France, still no way through this defence. Excellent work again by Kuznetsova, who's having a superb final here. And the frustration beginning to show on Lacrabert's face. The option there, of course, is to bring in Eglon. Came off a defender, it'll be a throw-in from the corner. Eglon being used as a defence specialist for France, but she might be an option to give Lacrabert a quick breather. Although the gap still four goals in the ninth minute. They're making no inroads on it. Oh, fortuitous goal for France, that was. Nyombla, or Dembele rather, happy to get that, but mistake by the keeper from that angle, should have had it covered.
8.5 minutes gone in this second half. France 10, Russia 13. Russia coming forward once more, out with Bobrovnikova, then into the middle for Akopian. Now at right back, Vakireva gets it into Bobrovnikova. Out again to Akopian, and that'll be a free throw to Russia. Pino getting the block in. 9 minutes on the clock. Russia leading by three goals. Bobrovnikova tries to get it inside to Anna Sen. Really well read, and now is there a chance of a breakaway? Dembele trying to get in and scoring. It all came from Laura Glossaire's quick release, and France 11, Russia 13 the score. It all came actually from Lacrobert's steal.
Quick ball out. And for once, the French managed to get ahead of the fast Russians. And two goals running for Siraba Dembele, the captain. And Irokina commits herself quickly in the ball, straight down to the far post. And suddenly, the French tails are up again. Fast break goals two now for France. Have they found the range? And has Lacrabert maybe now got a little bit of a spur? Too many steps. Ball turned over again. Eglon moving up in attack as well. Going to find herself a little bit in the way there with two right backs. And she'll head off, and France take their time now to rebuild the attack. I always wonder why they don't suddenly turn around and spin back in again when the change is being made, but it's Zielinskaya coming in with Vyakireva. And very, very slowly taking her time is Larissa Landré, who goes in on the line in place of Edwige. 10 minutes played then. Russia 13, France 11. Missed connection. Landré catching the ball at the same pace she came onto court with. Dmitrieva, well blocked again. The French defence has tightened up quite a bit now. And Edwige still coming on in defence.
France 11, Russia 13. Less than 20 minutes to go in this Olympic final. Either France or Russia are going to win their first ever Olympic gold medal. Vyakireva, oh, it's in. Laura Glossaire slams the four with her hand because she very frustrated to have conceded that goal. Just squeezed in under her left foot, and Russia get their advantage back up to three goals. Vyakireva driving across.
Shooting across her body. Shouldn't really have those opportunities, but that's happened twice. So France then on the attack, and the deficit goes back to three. Nyombla back again, he's got a big shot on her, but really hasn't brought it to play in this game. Iglon, meanwhile, is being left on in attack as Lacabert goes in as an extra line player. And Dembele not helping by going in there. And a bit of a space. Oh, why did she not run around herself? There was so much space for her to open up. They'll have to come back anyway. The whistle has gone after very long thought. I think the Russians may be keeping possession. We're waiting to see, but it's Lacabert, I think, who's gone down. And she's given the ball. And oh, shoulder barged out of the way by Dmitrieva. And is looking in some pain. And she does not go down easily either, Lacabert. She can take the knocks. And that will be a big concern. But why did she not try and run for the gap? She could have got the penalty, forcing Kuznetsova into her
left shoulder straight away from that collision. And Gerard Jouin and Annick Lenoir have made their way over to look at Lacabert, the doctor and the physio huddling round her. France 11, Russia 14, and that's going to be a concern for Krumholz. Gives a little thumbs up to someone, but you never want to see your star player down, especially if it is that left shoulder, because that is her shooting arm.
We're just waiting. She's sitting up, but she certainly is not looking like she's going to be in any state to continue at the moment, and visibly distressed. Trying to bounce the ball in. Legitimate run for her, but caught her. Got to worry about the clavicle. Well, meanwhile, Trefilov looking on. So far for the Russians, so good. Trying to stay focused, and Nziminko. So off she goes for some more treatment, and the problem with the French is that with the injuries they've had early in the competition, they really only have two other left wingers, and that's Iglon, left-handers rather. Prouvencier's the winger, and Iglon, it's her that takes over in that position. And there's Prouvencier, that's saved. So the Russians now may have a good opportunity through the misfortune of the French right back. There was the opportunity. Not a huge angle, but it was certainly doable. Near post maybe beckoning more than the far. And save rates for Russia 45%, although France at 44 is good as well. Let's not worry too much in terms of Iglon. She is a good goal scorer, 387 goals for France in 214 appearances. And a fumble there wastes a chance on the wing. So Iglon just waving in, and Nyombla has gone into the center while Pinot has gone left, and Lacabert, while a bit of a smile. Let's wait and see how serious it is as they fret over her. Under the new rules, if you go off for treatment, you need to miss the next three attacks. Suspect she needs somewhat more than that, to be honest, from the injury she's had. That's an attacking foul. Russia on the break. Cut back, Akopian. Dmitrieva off the post. Well, just for once, it's the other way. France take it quickly.
France 11, Russia 14, 13 minutes gone in the second half, and France really, sooner rather than later, needs to start to claw back. They've kept pace with Russia in this second half, four goals apiece, but still that three-goal deficit that they suffered in the first half means they need to start to get back on level terms. There is Lacabert, who looks like she's all sorted to a certain extent. They've taken off the ice pack on the shoulder. Nyombla, whistle goes. Free throw to the French. There's Kuznetsova, who's having such a good match so far. Pinot, turn from Aiglon out to Provencier. Not really going anywhere. Oh, there now they are. Fired in by Pinot, but I think she got a hit after she released the shot.
You see it from this angle here, and she really does. She's felled. And it's Dmitrieva again.
The shoulder, really, wasn't it, of Dmitrieva.
Well, the injury problems are mounting for France. They've already lost Lacabert. And Pino looks as if she's OK. She's got up, shakes her head and walks back down again.
And Olivier Krumholz has been given a warning, a yellow card in that. presumably because of his displeasure about the nature of those couple of Russian defensive moves. 14 minutes gone. I think both were the Russian players going for the ball more than anything else. Akopia inside to Diakireva, trying to find room for a shot. In the end, sets it up for Elina. Russia trying to get into space for a shot, brought down and too many steps. And now here's the counter-attack opportunity. Govoncier turns, plays it inside for Dembele. Finds the back of the net, and France are back to within a goal. And Olivier Klomholz is doing a little jig on the touchline because he can see the gold medal coming back into their sights. Great work from Provencier. The arm grabbed as she went for goal there, Dembele, but she still found the back of the net. France 13, Russia 14. And Akopian's been given a two-minute suspension in there for the grab on the arm.
It was very, very late coming, that suspension, but clearly pulled it way after the player had gone past. Chance maybe then for France to capitalise on the extra player. They've got no line player in. The Russians don't take out the goalkeeper when they're short-handed, never have done in this competition. That looked again like an attacking foul as Vyakireva is getting a little bit carried away in the attack, and the momentum of the Russian attack has gone slightly, although is that Dembele asking to be substituted? Can't really afford to lose too many of the experienced players. Lacrabert already off, and Pino still shaking her head occasionally, not looking entirely with it, to be perfectly honest. They've pushed the back player in on the line. The arm is up for the referees, and they've had several passes already, the Russians, on this passive play.
Saved by Glozer, straight forward for the French goalkeeper, just diving down to her left, and now here comes Pino into the roof of the net, and France are back level. 14 minutes to go in this Olympic final, and the French fans are on their feet. France 14, Russia 14. Alison Pino charging forward after the save from Glozer.
Three goals without reply for the French, and well beaten Irokina in goal. Could do nothing about that, and again it worked out, a good defense by the French. The Russians running out of time on their attack. Quick change by Dmitrieva. That's a free throw. They're staying in front, and suddenly there's renewed energy not only in the team but in the fans as well. Chance of Le Bleu ringing out around the arena as Elina tries to break through. Eglon is defending as if her life depends on it. Quick switch over. Dmitrieva comes around, little shot from Edwige on the way. Long attack, the passive play call again. Russians are back to full strength in the meantime, and Glossaire has got it. She's going through a great spell as well in goal for France. So Lacrabert is up, and Kumholt seems to want her back on again. Glossaire, great save. That was her fourth save from eight shots so far.
Provencier has just run off to the left-hand side and off the court, and emerging here into the right-back position is once again France's top scorer, Lacrabert, who heads on at left wing as well, and Niombla in the middle.
And into the right wing then goes Eglon, normally right back, but they're trying to keep the experienced players on here. She'll do all right, she's a left-hander. Lacrabert, who's not got away with too many shots here. Tried the wing, it's not there, looking for the line, under complete fumbling, given away, half-hearted attempt. There's a break on the first side, Yakireva! Is it? No, it's Sudakova, her first goal of the game. And the initiative slips back to Russia, who stem a tide of three goals without reply by the French.
Easily picked up by Kuznetsova, and still had a lot of work to do to go and find Marina Sudakova out on that right wing, and she fired it into the back of the net. And France now have called the timeout, maybe just to calm the players down a little bit, because the whole action on court, the whole future arena starting to get a little heated now.
Well, for Trefilov, nice and simple, but Kumholz saying you've got to be even faster on the fast break, but if it doesn't work, you really have to slow it back down again, because they're not. They're keeping going too fast, and that's the Russian pace. They're dictating it at the moment. as we see these great shots from the game so far. So faster on phase one, slow on the next phase if it doesn't go through. And also taking those long-range shots and planting them in the top corner. Those then the instructions from Kumholz. For Trefilov, I think it was just a rah-rah for his players. Keep it going, get the initiative back.
12 minutes left in the Olympic final. France 14, Russia 15. Both sides looking for their first ever gold medal.
So maybe Lacrabert wasn't fully fit. She's been taken back off again. And the switch, Pouvancier goes back in the wing and Aiglon is now in the back position. Little dummy by Pinault. Aiglon, attacking foul. Good static defense by Dmitrieva this time, and the Russians are moving the pace now. Zielinskaya straight down the center. Good save, Glusser, her fifth save. And immediately Pinault says, slow down now. And Glusser saying the coach said fast on the fast break. Slow on the set piece. There's the save again. Did very well indeed, the goalkeeper from Metz.
Zielinskaya hit her head on Pinault's leg on the way down, so that's why she's just rubbing the back of it there.
Well, still no Lacrabert, and maybe that first few passes made her realise that a shoulder is still problematic, but Aiglon, 9 goals in the competition, an experienced right-back. She's scored 59 for Nîmes in the season. Although the club subsequently went bankrupt this year, she's not had the greatest time there. Nziminko's come on in the middle now. She's got a very hard shot, but she hasn't really brought it to bear all that much in the competition, and certainly not in this game.
Out to Aiglon, back inside to Nziminko. Oh, given away. And I thought a Russian hand had got on that, but it's just thrown straight out of play. And now here come Russia again. Out to Dmitrieva. Back inside again to Zielinskaya, and she runs off, and basically that's exactly what Krumholz told the French to do. Get up there quickly. If it doesn't work out, take it nice and slow. So Dmitrieva in the centre.
Having taken a 3-goal run at the Russians, they've made 2 mistakes on the next 2 attacks and been punished each time. Both centre passes missing the connection with the right back. Nearly stolen, but that's opened up the wing. Oh, it's gone wide. Dembele gambled and went out to try and grab the ball, and in doing so, left so much space for Bliznova. There it is. You see the French player runs out, and it leaves the winger stranded with 2 attackers to mark. And Bliznova should have done better with that. She'll probably plead that she's a right back rather than a right wing, but her shoulder seems to take a blow on the way down.
France 14, Russia 15. We're into the final 10 minutes of the Olympic final. Played square, there's the shot, and it's pretty much straight at Erekina. And now Russia will try and come forward with the fast break. Bobrovnikova brought down. And Russia get possession back again.
Well, Landry quite literally bowls her over and then runs almost over the top of her. It's amazing, she didn't step on her. Charges off for the substitution in defence. And that's why she's not being left in defence, maybe. So, Bobrovnikova in the thick of it as ever. Dmitrieva is having a good game in the centre. Vyakireva, the right winger, who's played at right back the entire game, where she's had a fair measure of success here at these Olympics. Bobrovnikova cuts back towards the middle, well blocked by Pino, who says, I'm not doing anything. It's still a free throw. And time is running on the French here. More than anything else, though, the defence seems to work generally. Oh, nearly given away. Did that go over? Kumol sorted it. Dmitrieva into the wing, and that's how you do it. And this time, Bliznova on the bench as Vyakireva charges on and says, you see that? You try that next time.
So Russia retake their 2-goal advantage. Vyakireva slotting it in past Glozer. And we've got Tamara Horacek on the court, I think, for one of the first times in the match. Vyakireva is back on the bench. 4 goals from 5 shots so far. Here come France, out to Dembele. Dembele tried to drive in, I think, to have a chance of winning the penalty. And now here comes another fast break. Anna Sen saved by Glozer. Crucial one there for the French, because they are still only 2 goals down with 8 minutes to go.
Well, the goalkeepers must be cursing the attack. They are giving the ball away cheaply, France, not listening to the instructions. They're still playing too fast for their own good. But their finishing is just so frustrating. down on 40%, well below their standard, and an awkward return, did well, cut back diagonally. Bobrovnikova, first for her, but how important that could be. Pino connected, but then let her go at the back. Eglon couldn't move out, she was marking the line player.
France 14, Russia 17, with just 7 minutes left on the clock in this Olympic final. France need to get back on top after they scored three goals with no reply earlier on. That's the way to get it started. Larissa Landre finding the back of the net. The gap back down to two with 7 minutes left.
Well, it was a nicely worked goal, and she'd have got a penalty anyway. Bobrovnikova well inside with that shot. Leglon, the provider, who's covering for the injured Lacrabert. And so back they come. The French who bring to an end the run of three goals. For the Russians now, both teams have had those moments of domination. That's gone out. It's a throw-in, though, for Kuznetsova, who's asking for the floor to be mopped. You can see the sweat in front of Pino. Well, it'll help anyway that a team timeout has been called by Russia, and the teams go off. Trefilov needs to reset things. So the instruction is you've got to drive in to go on the attack. A little later, but a little faster. They're running in too early. They're having to check their runs, the French. For the Russians, well, they're punishing the French for their wastefulness in shooting at the other end.
6.5 minutes on the clock in the Olympic final. France 15, Russia 17 in what has been a fascinating women's handball tournament at Rio 2016. Bobrovnikova out to Vyakireva, driving in and scoring the goal. France 15, Russia 18. The gap back up to three now.
Good defence by Russia, forcing them back again. The substitution's being made. Eglon brings it out, and Horacek, who is on, number 22. Will go off. She's being used as a defender at the moment, trying to give a bit of a breather to some of the French attackers. Pace lacking, though. Well, no, she's on there now. Coming in for the injured right winger, but it does leave France with only one right winger, hence we've seen Eglon. And a long-range shot, a very poor long-range shot. But I guess at least she's got the nerve to do it in her very first major competition. Horacek, who only played her first matches for France earlier this year in the European Championship qualifiers against Iceland and Switzerland. This, I'm afraid, opposition of a rather higher calibre, if they won't mind my saying so. Bobrovnikova, and again across the goal, and that's a shot that has beaten Glossaire a couple of times before. Quick throw-off taken by the French, though.
And that is the shot that is starting to make the Russian players believe this could be their year. You can see the reactions on the bench of the players watching on out of the wing for Dembele. Back in it, France, 16-19. You just feel like we're going to get a grandstand finish here at the Future Arena. Great work from Bobrovnikova. Glossaire couldn't get there, but then straight up the other end for Siraba Dembele to fire it into the back of the net. Three goals in it still. 4.5 to go.
Given how hard the goals are to come by, three goals is a lot to make up for France, who've only scored nine in the second half. A little touch spotted there, and again, a late blow by the referees, and Zeminkur looks bemused. Bobrovnikova, I think, probably agrees with the call. But the clock is ticking away relentlessly, 4 minutes, and Trefilov getting anxious on the bench, but he always is. Long-range shot, oh, and a cheap one there for the French to concede. Dmitrieva taking a chance and coming away with a goal. Lead extended once more. Eglon forced into the wing as back will go Dembele, who'd come right across to help. There it is. Quick change of direction. Zeminkur didn't cover. And they were blocking inside the area anyway at the end. But it didn't matter because Dmitrieva scored.
Now here come France again with Pino One little bounce, then out to Niombla. Aiglon coming inside. Back again to Pino. Look how busy the Russian defence is. France trying their best to find some room. There is Trepelov bellowing on the touchline to his defence. Dembele, Pino, Niombla, little shimmy, and a good goal from Niombla. France 17, Russia 20, but we've got 3 minutes and 10 seconds left for France to rescue a three-goal deficit.
Lovely dummy shot with the right hand, switches to the left to get around the defender, back to the right to shoot. Her first goal only, though, and they're going to need a lot more than that. She hasn't quite taken the chances in the game so far. France have put Lino back in goal again. Bobrovnikova coming in. Dmitrieva, the industrious Vyakireva, looking for space, gets shoved over by France's Nzeminko. And it's a free throw, and the clock is still ticking away relentlessly. The time very much against France here. And the Russians looking good for goal, unless France can find something very special. And that's a penalty. Again, Vyakireva driving into 6 meters, causing problems. Gets around Edwige, and then Dembele having to back up, and she's standing inside the area, shoves her over. Rather crude, and Krumholz knows now that the opportunities for France are slipping away. Lino ponders as Ilina steps up to take up the penalty. Been on the bench for a while now. Way over the top, completely missed it. Is this a lifeline for France? If it is, though, they've got to sort out their shooting. Pino, yes, that's one back again. Within two now, France. Glossier can't believe, she shakes her head. The birthday girl on the bench watches as Pino, as far in the corner she could get, great height.
Yeah.
83 kilometers an hour, that shot, and we're inside the last 2 minutes. France are now defending very deep, and Nzeminko's pushing up. Edwige, the line will have a bit of space, but they're gambling. The Russians respond by putting in a second line player. Briefly, she comes back out again. No way through for Akopian, it's a free throw, but that's fine, it runs the clock down. The French are begging for the clock to be stopped. Norwegian referee shakes her head, but a team timeout, is it? It's a push. Arm taken, there you go. So, 1.5 minutes to go. Wants the players now to really be a bit more aggressive in defence, go up quick, and then let the Russians drive into you for the attacking foul so we can turn it over. You see some of these actions from the game so far. France trailing by 2, 1.5 minutes to go. The bench, well, cheering the goal, but then sitting down and realising it's still not there yet. Pino, he's done so much. So defender, long way out, trying to steal the ball. 1.5 minutes, it's enough time, but if Russia keep their heads, the gold is theirs. Passive play straight away, 6 passes to go. Krumholz waving his arms, they've had 3 there, 4, 5. And surely, 1 pass and a shot. Akopian! Oh! Diagonal shot again! The bench are in raptures, and that could be it! Akopian!
Here come France now, it's got to be now or never. Whistle goes for the free throw, but there's a minute left and they are 3 goals behind. Little fumble, picked up again, and the back of the net found by Nzeminko. 50 seconds.
It's got to be individual marking now as we see the goal again. Pino fumbles it, but somehow Nzeminko rescues the situation. Bit of luck for the French. Trefilov can't believe it, bellows the French from individually marking. Vyakireva does exactly the right thing, runs through the middle, looks for the foul. She gets it and the clock runs down, and surely passive play being worn, nearly stolen, and another goal, and that's it. Russia will take gold. France have tried so hard. but in the end, too many mistakes. The cheering is going on, their heads dropping ever so slightly. Too big a gap now. And maybe one last goal for the honour. Pino doesn't look interested. And there it is. Gold for Russia. What a moment for the team. They had defended superbly. And in the end, Trefilov called back to rescue the situation when Russia had failed to qualify for the World Championships in 2013. Returns to the glory days.
Silver in Beijing in 2008, 2005, 7 and 9, world champions Russia. But the success has been lacking in recent years. But Evgeny Trefilov has returned it. The players, most importantly, have returned it. The young players like Daria Dmitrieva, just 21 years old, Anna Vyacheva, 21 years old as well, have been absolutely instrumental. For France, they've made it to their first Olympic final. But for the 2003 world champions, it is not enough. And it finishes here in the gold medal match in the women's handball. France 19, the Russian Federation Olympic champions with 22. The various delegates and officials just being announced to the crowd here in the Future Arena. The bronze medal position after beating the Netherlands by 10 goals in the bronze medal match. It's Norway. They were on the top step at the last two Olympic Games in London and in Beijing. And there is Mrs. Ovita Rapia, IOC member of Papua New Guinea, to go out and award the bronze medals to Norway. So while it's not three golds in a row for a lot of these players, it is their first Olympic medal.
Well, it is still a great moment. You can never take away a medal in the Olympic Games. And as you say, for some of them, it is their first medal. It is a great occasion. For others, of course, they've got to reflect on what might have been. But that's behind them. We had some very good finalists here today. The Norwegians. We were hoping to emulate Denmark before them, who managed three back-to-back Olympic titles. 1996, 2000, and 2004, just couldn't quite manage it. But what a great moment, nevertheless.
Huge cheer for Nora Merck, as she also will end the tournament as the top goal scorer after an incredible performance, and it's her first Olympic medal.
Rafjord, one of the players who was going for a personal treble gold, and also Katrina Lunde next to her. And also Kristin Riegelhuth-Koren. Great legends of the game, one after the other, the three standing together, ironically, who together with Grimsbo had hoped for a third. You can't be too greedy.
They're doing a little selfie, though. Nevertheless, there is Camilla Herrem, who looks like she's recovered well after missing the shot that sent them out of the tournament. And then Sanna Solberg right at the end. The bronze medals for Norway after a very impressive performance from them here at Rio 2016. There's Mr. Per Bertelsen making his way up now to award the next medals after what has been a really entertaining tournament. And these, the small Rio 2016 statues to all the players once more. There's Emily Arntzen there receiving hers. Veronica Christiansen, who had a very good Olympic Games. I was really impressed with Christiansen.
Look at that. I mean, she's done everything, won everything. Still means a lot, and her great friend Nora Merck, who tempted her back into the national team after she decided to retire in 2014. And Frafjord, who picked up such a nasty injury in the quarter-final, but got herself fit and then played a key role in the remaining two games.
Especially impressive for Frafjord as she was out of the team from 2012 to 2015 after she did actually retire from handball with injury problems, but managed to make a comeback and great for her to get another medal.
As was Katrina Lunde, out for 4 years, and for that matter, Rigmor Hukkonen, 18 months out, all those players coming back. So there they are then, Norway bronze medalists in the women's handball competition at Rio 2016. A big cheer from the crowd.
Silver medals to the French team, and they've got over the defeat pretty quickly. Tears in the eyes of Laura Glossaire, who is celebrating her 23rd birthday today, and I can't think of many better birthday presents than a silver Olympic medal. In fact, I can think of one better one, but the silver will do for now.
Oh, poor old Glossaire, she's played such a a little call from the side, and it all it does is bring even more tears to her eyes as friends are calling across.
A strange mixture of delight and despair for the French. There's Alison Lenoe, who is seemingly, who is seemingly feeling very, very similar.
And in the middle of them is Aiglon, who was next to Glossaire, now has to turn around the other way and comfort Pinot. She's the one who's trying to keep it all together for everybody here. But still, what a moment. Down the far end, sadly, another rather glum face. We've got Lacabert with her arm in a sling.
If you'd have told Provencier at the start of August that she'd be getting an Olympic medal, I think she'd be a little bit surprised.
I think she probably would have been in there. Well, the most surprised player, Tamara Horacek, just going out of the picture, called into the squad today. She'd only played two international with France, was a reserve player, and with the injury to Bulut, came in and actually got on court, not for long, but she did set foot on court in an Olympic final on a debut in a major competition for France. Lino there, the goalkeeper. What a great career she's had. 185th international today. Dembele, captain, who's heading off to Russia. She'll have to be with teammates who will have bragging rights over her, but I'm sure they'll do it in the nicest possible way.
So there is Tamara Horacek, who after 4.5 minutes on court wins an Olympic medal. But take nothing away from her. She's earned her place in the French squad, coming in to fill in through injury. And there's Beatrice Edwige, who too had a strong tournament. Esther Enzeminko next up.
Oh, she's almost going to burst into tears. And there they come. And it's Nyombla. The two teammates from Fleury-Loiret, although she's off to Bucharest now for next season. And then Lacabert, who so unfortunately for France picked up that injury in that collision with Dmitrieva, came on briefly but realized nothing was right, and she's off. But a little smile. She stares at the medal. Never had an Olympic medal before. What an achievement. Smiling but can't quite bring herself to celebrate as some of her teammates are. And now the gifts to be presented by Miguel Rocamas, National Handball Federation first vice president.
The IHF have the World Championships, you have the European Championships, but the Olympics is still something a bit special for these players.
It is special. It's also the cream of the cream. If you think that the World Championships and now the Europeans have 24 teams, here you have to be in the top 12 to get yourself there. So already you're the elite of the elite when you start the competition. And yes, there is something, because it's every 4 years, the other competitions, well, they alternate each year, European, then a world, and European, then a world. But this, you've got to wait for a while. If you miss your chance here, you feel like, well, I may have missed my chance, I may never play in an Olympics. Whereas if you miss the European Championship, you go, well, I'll come back stronger at next year's World Championship. So, yes, it does mean a lot to them. And look, I mean, she is so taken by this. Edwige looks up to the heavens and thinking, I'm on the podium, I'm in the Olympics and I'm on the podium. Again, the reluctant handover, and Early inquires kindly about her arm, and she goes, ship up, I don't know. Hope for her it's not too bad. Great cheer from the French fans. They've been superb, they've been here en masse. They've virtually monopolised that place. And there they are then, France, silver medalists in the women's handball competition. We're nearly there. We're nearly ready for the top step, but there's still a little moment for France.
They don't want to lose the attention, do they, France? As they finish runners-up at Rio 2016. But now, the gold medalists onto the top step. Gold for Russia at Rio 2016 in the women's handball. Plenty of Russian fans as well. Zaisha Ganad Ali, an IOC member, about to pick up the gold medals and do the honours. And first up, Anna Sedoykina, who only played a couple of matches in the tournament before picking up an injury. Great to see her out there. Polina Kuznetsova, really impressive in the games as a whole and in that final in particular, as she hurtled down the left wing. Daria Dmitrieva as well. You could name five or six players in this Russian squad that have been really impressive.
They've had so much strength in depth, and everyone's pulled their weight in this team. With so many of the others, you've got a starting seven, a couple of players who can step in and do the business if they have to. Vyakireva there, absolutely outstanding in these Olympics, absolutely key to that gold medal. But they have got strength in depth. Their back line, they can put anybody on and cause problems to their opposition, as they did here.
Bobrovnik over there, overcome with that, and Victoria Zelinskaya, another example of a player that isn't maybe in the first seven, but when she comes on, she certainly makes an impact. Marenikova, 34 years of age, for her, maybe her last Olympic Games.
The captain, Irina Bliznova, has a message for the world. Well, maybe not. Maybe for some loved ones and dear ones.
And then at the end, the two goalkeepers that took part in the final, Tatiana Arakina and Victoria Kalinina at the end.
What a moment for Kalinina, whose only other appearance in a major competition was as a reserve coming into the World Championships last year. And now she's a gold medalist at Rio 2016. So up steps Dr. Hassan Mustafa, the president of the International Handball Federation. Final formalities, the small gifts of the player. Sedoykina trying to juggle gifts, medals and... it without toppling over from the end of the bench. Foot injury against Sweden, taking her out of the Olympics, but still on the podium, very much part of the team.
So Russia now, in women's handball, once again a real world force.
A real world force with a new style of handball, fast, effective, high scoring. France, the only team who've really kept them down, 22, 25 goals in the two matches, but each time it was enough because their defence was even more solid than the French one and kept them down. And yes, I think we're going to see them around for a while because there's some young players there, some exciting players. And as we were saying, so much strength in depth. And all credit to Yevgeny Trefilov, who stepped down in 2012. And when all went wrong, barely a year and a half later, and Krokin had to step aside, they turned back to him and he came back. And for all his barking, And for all the gravelly voice, he is a great coach, and the players do really, really like him. And they say if he's barking, it's because he wants the best for us. Well, today, he and the players truly got the best.
Once again, up at the two goalkeepers, Tatiana Arakina and Victoria Kalinina. And with the presentations complete, it is Russia who stand on the top step. Gold medalists at Rio 2016. The Russian Federation, after beating France by 22 goals to 19, are the Olympic champions. And what a tremendous performance from them, unbeaten in the competition.
Mesdames et messieurs, l'hymne de la Fédération de Russie.
Ladies and gentlemen, the anthem of the Russian Federation.
Senhoras e senhores, o hino da Federação da Rússia.
Podium.
Senhoras e senhores, as medalhistas olímpicas.
So Russia on the top step, they are the gold medalists. France finishing second, defeated in the final, and it's Norway who beat the Netherlands comfortably in the end in the bronze medal match, that are on the third step of the podium. A fascinating, enthralling, exciting women's handball tournament at Rio 2016 ends with Russia as the champions.